Let me first congratulate Jill Majamu for waging what must be considered one of the most courageous political campaigns. I want to try to explain that in a while. But, of course, welcome to Philadelphia, the city of Mumia Abu-Jamal, of Pan-Africa,
yes.
Of Move Nine,
yes.
The city of Richard Allen, Bishop Richard Allen, of the African Methodist Episcopal Church, of Ovi Kayo, one of the early martyrs in the struggle for the right to vote here in Philadelphia. Philadelphia is a city of great churches, of great institutions of resistance. This is the city not only of the African Methodist Episcopal Church and of its mother congregation, Bethel. It is also the city of the African St. Thomas Episcopal Church. It is the city of Mother Zor African Methodist Church. It is the city of the great Mother Dabney of the Garden of Prayer and Sister Rosie Wallace, two congregations going back over 50 years ago that were welcoming of the LGBT community here in Philadelphia. This is a great city, a city of struggle, a city where W.E.B. Du Bois wrote the landmark sociological study, The Philadelphia Negro, not far from here. But this is a good time. This is the best of times, and it's the worst of times. The two systems that are pillars of the American nation, the white supremacist social system, and the capitalist economic system are both in crisis. It is what Karl Marx called a momenti mori, using the Latin phrase, a reminder of death. So this is a strange election in a unique moment in American history. I think we can confidently say, after this election, this country will never be the same again. It will never be the same because the people of the United States are not the same as they were before this election. And in large measure, we have to express our gratitude to the Green Party and Jill and Ajamu. Where the people are coming to themselves. And ironic as it might seem, the masses of people are shedding old habits and old ethics of racism, of patriarchy, of ethnic and religious biases. And in coming to themselves, they're coming to a consciousness of what class means in this country. That race, that whiteness, that great fetish, that great obscuring ideology cannot and will not solve the problems of the American people, and white Americans are waking up to that fact. The easiest thing to do, and it's always been easy to do, is to write off working people in general, and white working people in particular. But you go to the Midwest, where plants are closed down. You go to places like Cleveland and Lorain, Ohio. Go to Pittsburgh. Go to central Pennsylvania. And you ask them, if their whiteness, that fetish, is protecting them from the predation of the oligarchs that run this country.
No.
This is a great class awakening time. And for those of us on the left, we need to get on our own 2 feet. Stop following the liberals.
Yes.
And their prejudices.
Yes.
You know, if you're burdened by the myth of the American dream, if perchance you are located close to or in the petty bourgeoisie or the upper middle class, the crisis of capitalism can catch up with you too. So this is a period of class awakening. You can call it the beginnings of a new class struggle. You know, for all of those leaders and misleaders of labor and black people, I think their day is coming to an end. I don't know what's going to happen on Tuesday, but I believe there's going to be a rebellion from the ranks of labor and from the ranks of black people. I've been to Chicago all my life, and I'm proud to say that. And I've observed and taken part in a lot of elections. I even ran in one election for Congress. I have never seen in the black community such a turnoff after so much money has been spent to get them out to vote. Black folk are not going to vote in the numbers that the Clinton campaign thinks they're going to vote in. This will be a rejection of the black misleadership class. And I don't have to go into a lot of detail to tell you what black leadership of these major cities looks like. It's just the same old management and rule in a different color. Black folk have always been in the forefront of class consciousness. And we are today, but it takes forms that you don't find in a textbook. Sometimes it takes the form of refusing to go along with what your so-called leaders tell you to do. They say vote, we say we don't think so. That's an act of protest, an act of resistance. They say a vote for Jill Stein is a vote for Trump. They say, well, I'm voting for Jill Stein now. It got so bad in Philadelphia that the black misleadership class had to begin to invent a number of myths to scare black folk into voting.
That's right.
Trump was not enough.
That's right.
The latest, because they're not afraid of Trump.
No, we're not.
The latest one was that white militias and white supremacist groups were coming into the black community on election day, and they were going to be giving out free weed and free 40s to keep black people from voting. It's a joke, but that's how desperate they've gotten.
That's right.
The same thing in the labor movement. The rank and file are tired of being told that you vote for the lesser of two evils.
That's right.
When that lesser of evils has supported war, trillions of dollars. Like NAFTA and the TPP,
right.
And it supported the prison industrial complex.
That's right. That's right.
So I think election day is going to be a day of rebellion, a day of refusal to go along. And in advance, I want to congratulate the masses of working people of the United States of America. Because now we are on the verge of making our own history. But this is a time of danger. We're in a new Cold War and a new McCarthyism. As with the first Cold War, the major issue for our nation and humanity is global peace and preventing thermonuclear war. For war, and at the same time for reform. Martin Luther King was right. War is the enemy of the poor. And I would add, war is the enemy of reform. War is the enemy of democracy. And any candidate that surrounds themselves with the likes of John Negroponte, the genocidist in Latin America, Robert Kagan, and the rest of the neocons, if that candidate is going to stand and tell us that she is the candidate of reform domestically, if we fall for that, we'll fall for anything.
Right.
If you remember, in the first Cold War, claimed that he was on a search and destroy mission, searching out Soviet agents in the State Department. Y'all remember that? You maybe heard of it. Well, now we've come 180 degrees, where the head of the FBI is now being targeted as an agent of a foreign government.
Wow.
But then anybody that disagrees with Hillary Clinton is an agent of a foreign government. Jill Stein is an agent of Donald Trump. And Donald Trump is an agent of Putin. And Julian Assange is an agent of Putin as well.
Wow.
Putin is the most powerful man in the world today. In fact, any and everybody who opposes Clinton and her policies of war, austerity, domestic repression, are agents of something other than the fight for peace. Yeah. I'm reminded in this situation of W.E.B. Du Bois, the great scholar and activist, who was indicted in 1951 as an agent of a foreign government, the Soviet Union, because of his work for peace and against nuclear weapons. He said at that time, in response to his accusers, "I'm not an agent of any government. I'm an agent of peace." Yes. The Green Party is not an agent of any government, including the United States government.
Right.
They are an agent of peace. He wrote a book entitled Color and Democracy, Colonies and Peace. And there he responded to the red baiters and war makers. He said, and I quote, And this could aptly be applied to Jill and the gentleman. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called communists.
I was trying to form my own cult. I was like, what is Hollywood?
Is that praise for the communist or condemnation for the peacemakers? And we can say on this occasion, blessed are Jill and Ajahn. In the black church, for they shall be called everything but a child of God. But is that praise for their accusers or condemnation of them? It is praise for them and their heroism. And unlike their accusers, and unlike the accusers of W.E.B. Du Bois and Paul Robeson and hundreds of others, they are on the right side of history. Being called an agent of a foreign government, in this case Russia, is in fact praise for the Greens, who are the peacemakers. A vote for the Greens is a vote for peace. And peace is the paramount question at this moment in history. Don't get it twisted. We are on the cusp. Unless we, the people, can unite and act urgently, we are on the cusp of what could become a world war. You know, world wars don't start as world wars. They start as small wars that gradually consume humanity. America is losing in the world. New things are happening in the world. I don't care if it's the Philippines or Turkey, Russia or China. It's a new world. People are no longer interested in a single superpower-dominated world. People are no longer interested in the white supremacist habits and ethics of the American oligarch. And the American people are part of that forward march of humanity. The great abolitionist preacher, Theodore Parker, said in the 19th century, the arc of the moral universe is long, but it bends towards justice. And that is true for our time. And the great black abolitionist, Henry Highland Garnett, said, let your motto be, resist, resist, resist.
Yes.
We can win. The resources for victory are within our people.
That's right.
So much depends upon the political integrity and moral foundation of those who seek to lead our people. Do we have the courage to go among the least of these? Those who many of us in the past had written off, and join them with their sisters and brothers in the urban ghettos. You know, Philadelphia, of the 10 largest cities, is the poorest. Don't get it confused. What you see around here is not Philadelphia.
Wow.
This is the Philadelphia they want visitors to see. But I can take you up to Broad Erie. I can take you out to 52nd and Market. I can take you not far from the great gentrifier and abuser of the black community, Temple University. This is building huge towers, but they pay no taxes.
Right.
This is a city where the University of Pennsylvania has never paid the city taxes. This is a city that is more economically and racially segregated and divided today than perhaps ever in its history. But the potentiality of uniting the people is great, because we are all recognizing that we're in the same boat. The system is unraveling. This is the best of times and the worst of times. It is a momenti mori, a reminder of systemic death. We have to exercise our agency and take command of the situation. Thank you very much.
It seems challenging. I don't say hard because the only thing hard is the concrete that we walk on. Everything else is a challenge. So I'm ready for this challenge, and I was built for this. I think we all have a purpose in life, and mine.